Hey now, Rodney Erdickson here, and this is my review of the ZTE N860 Android smartphone as provided through Public Mobile in Canada. It's important to note that I've been finding much conflicting information as far as the specifications of this device online. Some claim it to be a resistive touchscreen that does not support multi-touch. Others claim it to have a capacitive touchscreen that does support multi-touch. I myself am not equipped to determine whether the technology of the touchscreen is in fact resistive or capacitive, but I can tell you that my device is multi-touch. So what does that mean? Does that mean that the screen is capacitive, or is it rather resistive but in fact supports multi-touch? The reason I'm hesitant of relying on any stats, or any specifications, I should say, that I find online is due to the issue of my purchase of the Samsung Galaxy W some time ago. Some time ago, I purchased the Samsung Galaxy W based on the specifications I found online, and as it turns out, the specifications that I was basing my purchase on were specs for the American version of the Samsung Galaxy W. As it turns out, in Canada, the Samsung Galaxy W is a lower spec phone, which is closer to the Samsung Galaxy Exhibit 4G in the States, or Samsung Galaxy Exhibit 2 4G in the States. So as soon as I start to come across conflicting specification information, I hesitate to commit to one over the other. So suffice to say, I will not be showcasing any internet-based specifications on this video. I'll just tell you what I know is fact. So, the ZTE N860 Android smartphone uses Android 2.3 Gingerbread. Since this is issued through Public Mobile in Canada, it's based on CDMA technology. That is to say that it does not support a SIM card. Rather, it's configured and tailored to work on but one provider, in this case Public Mobile. The screen is in fact 4.3 inch. The screen is an 800x480 resolution screen. It has 512 megs of internal RAM, and the storage space, not including micro SD card, is 2.5 gigs of usable internal storage space. Now, important to note, despite the 2.5 gigs of internal storage space, a micro SD card is still necessary to perform many, many things on this phone, including downloading from the web, downloading files from the web, taking pictures, taking video, and caching maps and, caching map tiles in Google Maps. The battery in passing is a lithium ion of 1600 mAh. So, right now I'm going to show you the installation of the battery. There are contacts at the top, and a notch right over here. Here you could see the contacts right here that need to be matched up. So I am going to take the battery. It's kind of confusing because there's print on both sides. I'm going to match up the contacts as so. And provided it's within that notch, I'm then going to slide it in securely beyond the thumbnail space to eject it. The micro SD card, the installation of it is interesting as there's no spring-mounted system and no swinging latch. However, I do have to say that this system that is employed on the ZTE N860 for installing a micro SD card probably works better than any other system I've used. There's no risk of a spring breaking or a spring release breaking, thus causing your card to constantly pop out, and there's no latch to break off. So it's a simple tension system. You slide it in there, provide a bit of pressure, and boom, le truc est joué, as we say in French. It's in there. It's held simply at the top contacts, and it will function in the phone. I'm now going to apply the back cover. The back cover is rather light and flimsy, but what does it matter? Snaps in rather easy. I'll continue with a physical tour of the phone. As you can see on the front is that 4.3 inch 800 by 480 touchscreen, multi-touch in my case. ZTE branding at the top. Here is the earpiece. To the left of the earpiece is a light sensor. To the right of the earpiece is a charge light, which lights red when charging and green when fully charged. At the bottom of the device, you have four tactile soft buttons, so you have home, menu, back, and search. Around the screen is a silver or shiny chrome-esque border, which is reminiscent of the iPhone 3 or the Samsung Galaxy Geo. To the left, once again in chrome, is a rocker button for volume. As you can see, it's contoured, which fits the thumb nicely. Here, I believe, that is a hole to pass a dragon, a wrist strap, or a dangly thing that people like to put on here. In the lower left is a fingernail slot in order to remove the back cover. The microphone porthole is also in the lower left. On the right side, there is the quick camera shutter button. There is the micro USB form factor port or jack. At the top is the 1/8 inch stereo audio mini jack, 3.5 millimeters, for such things such as earphones, headphones, headsets with integrated microphone, hands-free kits, whole deal. Your sleep-wake button's on the top. It seems to be of cheap, flimsy plastic. It's not too impressive compared to the other buttons on the device. To the back, you have the rubberized backing. It could be just a soft plastic, but it feels rubberized. It's indicated Public Mobile at the back here, with a ray pattern which emits from the middle right and spreads out across the phone. Here is the loudspeaker. Your ZTE insignia. Not sure why this is so scratched up. It's important to note that I bought the device used. Not so sure why that's scratched up. Perhaps the dongle or wrist strap or whatever you have passes through there. I'm not sure. And finally, the 5-megapixel camera with flash, which I do have to say, in this case, is completely ruined. And I'm not surprised. I think that ZTE really made a poor choice in how they positioned their camera in relation to the back cover. The camera protrudes outside of the dimensions of the back cover, which means that whenever the phone is laid down, what's it laying on? It's laying on the back cover. It's laying on the camera module, which would explain all of these scratches, scuffs, and otherwise damage to the camera module, which is unfortunate. Without further ado, boot up the device so you can see the boot up time. Red light, Public Mobile. Right now I have the brightness set to lowest. By the way, the camera has an autofocus. I could tell because the camera just clicked. The camera is of 5 megapixels, by the way. And here we go. We're already in the operating system. What just happened? Activate my phone. This is my fault. I forgot to turn on wrong button. I apologize. I did it out of force of habit. I forgot to turn on airplane mode. When you hold the power button, you have access to airplane mode. There we go. That should not bother me anymore. The need to activate the phone. Since the phone doesn't have a SIM card, since it uses CDMA technology, technically you could always connect to the cellular towers unless you put airplane mode on. And as a result, if you don't activate the phone on the network, it'll always bother you to do so. Turn off GPS while I'm at it. Important to note that in the in the notifications area, you do not have access to these quick on-off button widgets, which is unfortunate. Rather, it's a widget bar that you can place on a home screen, which I did just now. I'm going to get on my network right here. I'm also going to disable Fongo. I can tell you that I won't go into details, but, I won't go into an example, I should say. But both Fongo and Text Plus work very well on this unit, I do have to say. Bear with me. There we go. Okay, very good. That shut down. So, as mentioned, the device uses Android 2.3 Gingerbread. On the widget panel, you can quickly enable or disable Wi-Fi, Bluetooth, GPS, data network transfer, auto-rotate screen, and you have quick access to brightness. As mentioned prior, both Fongo and Text Plus work as intended. I just remembered I should format that SD card that I just inserted, as I have not, I just kind of just inserted it on a whim to do this review. There we go, that should be fine. Okay, very good. As you can see, internal storage, you have 2.43 available gigs to you. Right now I placed a 4 gig micro SD card in here. What's interesting about the ZTE N860 is you have this Filer app. And the Filer app, what you can do is you can explore the contents of both the SD card and the system. However, unfortunately, they only give you access to certain files, which is unfortunate. Home directory is default, that's fine. Recursive delete, delete non-empty directories. Yeah, okay. Back button exits, hide dot files. Ah, file types. Okay, whatnot. Let's see now if we could see what we want to see. SD card, media, no. System, media. See, that's what I don't like. It's nice that you have the option. It's like rename, delete properties. However, the software, the Filer software, only gives you access to certain files, which is unfortunate. Let's go over maps. I'll do a quick example. While I'm doing this, I should mention that this device, since I didn't give specs on its weight, for its size, is fairly light. It's noticeably light. Now, this could be due to the thin, cheap plastics that it uses, but I am very, very much impressed by the weight of the device, especially considering its screen dimensions. Also, once again, this is perhaps attributable to the thin plastics used in the device, but this device gets better Wi-Fi reception than any other Android smartphone or tablet that I could remember testing to date. So very, very impressive. Here you go. Here's an example of Google Maps. Let's get some Street View in here, so I could show off Street View. Is that Street View? Street View. Here we go. Give you a chance to see the 800 by 480 screen. It should be noted that the one of the technologies reported to be employed on screen is an anti-scratch surface. which I've also noted in the Kyocera Rise when I was testing that smartphone. The screens are not as brilliant, as we say. It's not as reflective, but it seems to employ an anti-scratch technology. Okay, so that is Google Maps and Street View. I do have to say, it does work very well. I read online one criticism that the GPS takes a tremendous amount of time to connect to the GPS satellites. I didn't experience that. It did take time, but nothing out of the ordinary of what I'm used to seeing for Android smartphones. And I can tell you right now that the GPS was quicker, the GPS technology, excuse me, was quicker to connect to GPS satellites than many other Android smartphones I have used. So there you go with Maps. I'm going to do YouTube off camera. Not that it matters. I could show you this even if I'm logged in. Once again, my wireless network can be slow right now. Just going to look for myself. I will have to go over this keyboard afterwards. This keyboard, as we say in French, is a petit bijou. Prior to this, I always believed Samsung to have the best keyboards, the best virtual keyboards on an Android device. That might have changed with this device. Given the speed of my network, I can't promise you that it will load, but I do hope it does. For the most part, I was impressed with the visual quality of the video in YouTube on this device when it does work. But once again, if it doesn't work, it's not the fault of my of the ZTE N860 rather, but it's the fault of my network. Shame right now there's not movement. There we go. As you can see, the movement is very nice. The resolution is very nice. And overall, it looks very well. As mentioned prior, my network isn't working too well, so that's unfortunate. Download allows you to see your downloads. That's fine. Email. The email application on this device would have to be perhaps the best variant of the email application I've ever used on an Android. It's slightly different than the standard email application you generally see. And because of that, what I can do is I could do, I could, for example, set the email application to download all of my messages, my entire inventory of messages. I could set the email application to download everything in offline mode, so I could see it in offline, including pictures and attachments. The, what was I going to say? The app itself allowed for zooming out of download the message. I hate that. I guess I didn't configure it right. Bear with me. I'm sorry, it's amateur hour. See, what happened was I, as you can tell, I had to put a micro SD card in the phone, and that's because I had removed the previous one and coincidentally formatted the previous one, and the previous one had all of this information. Download options, full message. What's going on? Why aren't you working? Maybe it's still downloading it? That's a shame. I really want to show you this right now. And I know whenever I have the option, I could show you this, select download to download the message. Generally, it doesn't doesn't appear, or it doesn't appear in reasonable time. Anyway, suffice to say, I've mentioned all the benefits. This email app also allowed me, using my Yahoo Mail, to actually send out email. Not all email apps allowed me to do that in the past. This one allowed me to pinch zoom out of HTML messages, which is so useful. Every other Android-based email app I had used prior did not allow me to pinch zoom out of HTML messages. So what that means is, when looking at a HTML message, since I couldn't pinch zoom out and it would always display beyond the screen size, I'd always have to scroll around to see the entire message. And in addition, I wasn't able to scroll the message diagonally. It was only in an up, down, or a left, right motion. So what I'd have to do is I'd have to scan the whole message. Let's say this was the message, and this was my view. I'd have to start up here, move like this. Okay, very good. Go down, then move like this. Since I was only able to move on the X and Y axis, so it was very frustrating. That's really unfortunate that this is not working right now. There we go. Okay, good. This one downloaded. Maybe it just needed some time. I apologize for that. Waiting for it to load images. Watch this. Beautiful. First of all, the header always remains, which is strange. You can't zoom out the header. But what I can do, I could pinch zoom out of messages, and I can't tell you how important that is to me. Slide around my message, zoom in, zoom out, of course. When it works, it's not that the screen is not responsive, it's that we're in the middle of July here in Quebec, so it's extremely hot and humid. As a result, I'm sweating, and it's muggy, and the screen's not very responsive when you have sweaty, humid hands. Oh, I'm sorry. That's great, I just showed that online. Let's see what I showed, just going on over this. Nothing terribly personal, but still. Okay, so, Task Manager, God bless it. Is it as good as how Samsung handles task managing? No, but it's still brilliant, love it. You know what? Email, I'm done with email. Close that. Done, goodbye. Facebook, I don't use Facebook. Goodbye. You know what? I'm tired of all of this. Kill them all. Kill all. Boom. Done. Task Manager. What's opened? Just that. Beautiful. I love it. I love a Task Manager that's efficient. This one is especially efficient. I like that. In the Task Manager, you could also go into applications and you can modify certain things, such as clearing data, forcing stop if it's running, clearing cache. Very, very, very useful, especially considering that it can be as simple as a finger touch away. Let's go into applications of the device. Alarm was interesting. Alarm, what I can do is is it clock or alarm? I think it's alarm. I could set a night mode. The night mode will just show the time, which is night. I could set an alarm whereby I have to enter a captcha in order to disengage the alarm. I tried it live in my overview video and it didn't work, but I did it very quickly. I don't know if I had to configure it properly, but regardless, let's go over browser. Let me show you browser. Okay. What do we have in browser? Well, let me show you just the site. Show you Yahoo. Love Yahoo. Loading up Yahoo. Okay, here we go. Now, what can we do with the browser? New window. Adds a new window immediately. Here I want to go to... Where do I want to go to? eBay. Should load up mobile eBay. HP, mobile web. How disgusting. Okay. I could stop the loading. What else do we have? windows. I could see my windows. I could switch to them on the fly, or I can kill them. Or close, I should say. Close the windows. Got refresh. Got more. What do we have on more? Add bookmark. Select text. Page info. Settings. Anything useful in settings? Text size, default zoom, overview, text encoding, block pop-ups, load images, autofit, landscape only, enable JavaScript, enable plugins, which is nice, open in background, set homepage, clear cache, clear history, accept cookies, member form, data, clear form, enable location, member passwords, security warnings, set search engine. It doesn't seem that there is the ability in the browser to set the about user agent line. Let's see for fun if it works. Unless it's here. Not to my knowledge. I'd have to close some browser windows, wouldn't I? I could exit the browser, which is close all tabs, which I like. Let's try it again. ABOUT. Suggested abortion, just saying. Not sure what. User agent. Oops. Let's see if that works. I spelled it right? No, it doesn't. Doesn't seem like as I could do that on this browser. Which is unfortunate. Let's make sure I look properly through the settings. Text encoding, nope, that's wrong. Nope, doesn't seem like I could do that in this browser, which is unfortunate. But nonetheless, despite the terrible terrible state of my wireless network right now, I'm going to try to bother to show you watch.ctv.ca. As it turns out, the device does support Adobe Flash, and it's not equipped on the ZTE variant Android operating system. You have to download it yourself. Download it and install it yourself. And as you can see, on watch.ctv.ca, which is probably the most demanding video website I know, at least available to Canadians, the video is choppy, but it's still viewable, which can be better than some other some other devices, I should say. Hopefully this will work. I swear I hope this music isn't copyright music. That's what I need. My video flagged for copyright infringement for showing an ad. Anyway, regardless. So the phone does support, bear with me, does support Adobe Flash. However, video playback is not ideal. However, it should be noted that I was just showing a very demanding website. If I go on, for example, globaltv.com, video plays just fine. Now I'm going to go into my beautiful task manager and end it all. Kill them all. Moving on. Calculator, we know. Calendar, call log, we know. Camera and camcorder. Camera is fine. It works. It's 5 megapixels. Focus mode auto, exposure, 5 megapixel, super fine, color effect, auto ISO, auto banding, saturation, contrast, sharpness. Okay, that's all fine. Could store location, we don't want that. White balance is auto. Flash mode is off. We'll leave it off for now. And zoom is 1x. As mentioned prior, the camera's fine. It does what it needs to, for example. as a focus. There we go. The images are 5 megapixel. They're fine. There's a flash on the device. Oh, I almost forgot to mention. You need a micro SD card installed within the phone in order to take pictures and video. Which is too bad considering there's 2.4 gigs of usable storage space. I don't know why, but you do. Here's the problem with the flash. There is a flash. Very good. Does the flash have a use? Practically not. Let's go over that, shall we? That is the photo with flash. Is there any use for such a photo? Unless you're making a Ghost Lab or Ghost Hunters knockoff show. Is there any use for a flash that bright? It's practically useless. Without flash, very decent. The color, the resolution, everything of the photo is very nice. With flash, forget it. Flash is completely useless on this phone, sadly. Unless you're using it as a flashlight, although there's no flashlight app that comes equipped on the ZTE variant Android operating system. Or if you're using it perhaps in the extreme dark to take pictures, let's say at night, inside the engine bay of your car, for example. So you're just taking pictures to get information and not wanting to use the pictures for anything, then I guess it has a purpose. But other than that, flash is completely useless. Video. Video is disappointing on this device. The best it can do is VGA, which is fine, 640 by 480. But the best it can do is 13 frames a second. So that's to me, it's not usable. And I'd have to get an edge. If you could look at the screen and pay attention to this edge. Look what happens when you shake about the device. I don't know if you can notice it, but the video itself is wavy. It waves. Similar to very low-quality mobile cell phone cameras. Let's do a live video, live example. This is a live example. I'm going to be moving both the phone and my hand to show. This phone could really benefit from some stabilization. Boonk. No. Play.
This is a live example. I'm going to be moving both the phone and my hand to show.
The microphone is very good. Really benefit from the loudspeaker plays the recording very well. However, at under 13 frames a second, and that silly, maybe the reason they call this phone a ZTE Warp in the States is because it warps your videos. It pretty much warps and distorts the image like that. It's really sad. Camcorder is sorely disappointing. Camera is fine, though, as long as you don't use flash. Contacts, we don't care about. Dialer, we don't care about. Docs2Go. Apparently, Docs2Go can open Microsoft Word, PowerPoint, Microsoft Excel, can open PDF. That's fine. In order to compose any of these items, they want you to upgrade to the full version of the app. So essentially, it's a limited trial app you get on there, which is sorely disappointing. Downloads is downloads, very good. Easy Wi-Fi. Easy Wi-Fi is an app provided by Public Mobile, which essentially does nothing more than what you can do in settings to notify me when a new wireless network is available. I think the difference is Easy Wi-Fi will auto-connect to any open wireless network, which is a security risk, by the way. You should, unless if you ever use any apps that transmit personal information, such as login information, you should never use open Wi-Fi hotspots. Why? Because if the person behind the open Wi-Fi hotspot is honest, nothing to worry about. If they're a little crooked, they can record, basically keylog, everything that your phone transmits and receives. Very dangerous. Email we went over. Facebook I don't use, can't show you. Filer we went over. Gallery I showed you. Gmail doesn't matter. Google settings doesn't matter. Google Plus I don't use. Latitude, forget it. I'm not telling people where I am. Maps, messages, Messenger. Not going to use. Messages using the keyboard. Maybe I should show that right now. Where would I do that? Well, I could do that in the email. Bear with me. This might take some time. Compose. Okay. I'm going to send an email to... It doesn't matter. Can I just compose mail? Yes, I can. Let me show you this awesome keyboard. It's called TouchPal. TouchPal comes equipped on the ZTE N860. Unfortunately, this functionality doesn't work as I wish it would. There's an option to choose languages on the fly. The first time I did it, when I selected French, and I started speaking in French, it was typing out in French, which I loved. But for some reason, it never worked as intended afterwards. TouchPal has its own version of swipe. So you could, like, for example, swipe your finger from Q to U to A to L and get quality by just moving your finger. I don't care for it, so it's there for those who do. I don't care for it. You have quick options to cut, copy, paste, space, delete, select all, home, and end, and arrows to move around within your text, which is very useful. Useful, I should say, especially, let's say, a word's misspelt and you got to get your little cursor between the words. Instead of trying to move that little cursor, you could just move your selectors like that, which is great. The speech-to-text module is included with the ZTE N860. It's tailored for the, what's this called again? The TouchPal keyboard. What I appreciate about it is it's not like the standard Google voice search speech-to-text engine. Let me explain, or let me illustrate. So like I was telling you yesterday, today is a pretty, pretty lousy day, period. I have a preview window. So let's say the interpretation of what I said is completely wrong. I don't have to go through the trouble of deleting it. I could select it before it gets posted. And once again, let's say there was mistakes. Bring out those arrows, move that cursor, make the modifications I need to, which is great. So that works great. I happen to love that. Also the keyboard, I don't know if you notice it, but the keyboard has secondary functions, and you access these by just long holding your tap. So let's say I was putting an email. Rod, I need an at. It's right underneath the L. Hold L. There it is. At email.fake. See? As simple as that. There's a bunch of functions. There's numbers that you could access that way. There's common what would you call those? Symbols. Thank you. Symbols. Such as $, underscore, forward, backslash. Things of that nature. Quotes. You also have, of course, your space is your space bar, as well as the ability to turn on the swipe functionality. It's actually prediction settings. Oh, no. See, it's for the swiping. So like I was saying, I'm curious. Now that that's on, will this work properly? Bear with me as I do an on-screen test. Here's all the languages that it supports without downloads. Est-ce que aujourd'hui est possible pour vous? No. See, that's the problem. Oh, wait. I'm sorry. Pourrez-vous me confirmer si aujourd'hui est possible pour toi? No, that's my problem. It worked for me the first time, but now it just doesn't. It refuses. That I could just switch like that? Really is disappointing. It would be great if it was as easy as so, but it's not. So yeah, you have those secondary buttons, you have the speech-to-text engine, which is great. You can minimize and maximize the keyboard. You also, what else do you have here? You have quick access to comment period. Here's your secondary keyboard, your tertiary, and your fourth, which has http://www.com and .net. Oh, and smileys, because, you know, smileys are fun. Okay, well, there you go. That is the TouchPal keyboard, which is very, very, very useful, in my opinion. Let's kill some apps. Love killing apps. Okay. Music, I didn't touch it. Navigation. Let's touch on navigation. With the micro USB charge cable connected and charging, and with a micro SD card installed within the device, using Google Maps navigation works very well. I was able to use it to drive 45 kilometers. So, no, I should say 45 minutes, excuse me. 45 minutes, so we'll say maybe 30, 35 kilometers, with navigation leading me the whole way with high-resolution maps, even doing rerouting when I miss a turn and what have you. This is all offline with no data connection. Mind you, as mentioned prior, you do need a micro SD card installed in the device in order to use this functionality properly. If you don't, then your maps, after you exceed perhaps a kilometer, or your navigation maps, will become fuzzy and, you know, roads are jagged. You could still make out where you have to go due to the on-screen prompts, and the path line is still always clear, but the actual surroundings regarding the illustration of the roads and the turnoffs and what have you are all jagged and fuzzy. Surprisingly, Google Maps, without the micro SD card in, did not permit for elective caching of map area, where I select what map area gets cached. However, I let pre-caching do its magic, you know, where you specify. No, I'll show you. It's quicker that way, I apologize. In Google Maps, in settings, cache settings, automatic caching. Automatic caching while charging and using Wi-Fi only. So, since I had my phone connected to a power source, I had mapped out where I wanted to go, and I left the phone down for maybe 5 minutes, 10 minutes, without micro SD card, but just left it there. Once again, around 35 kilometers, 45 kilometers, the map in Google Maps was still crisp and clear. I could zoom in, zoom out, no problem. It's only navigation that really required that micro SD card to be present in order to get a defined, clear map view. News and weather, it doesn't matter. Notepad's a notepad, that's fine. Places, who cares? Playbooks. You could buy books from the Google Play Store to read them, that's nice. Google Play Store worked as intended, no problem. Public mobile is but a shortcut to the public mobile website. Google search works. Settings, went through settings. Settings are pretty standard, nothing to write home about. Good old Android 2.3. Siren. What Siren is, now this is for public mobile clients only. I'll be brief with this. Siren is essentially kind of like an iTunes music store, although there is no cost to download music. All you have to do is you do have to be on the $45 a month plan with public mobile, and provided you're on the $45 a month plan, you have unlimited music downloads, which includes full albums, singles, many, many, many popular artists. It's very interesting, but it is at the $45 a month plan. Sound recorder? Yeah, what the heck, we'll try it. This is an example of the sound recorder, which had a delay before it launched. It's on my card. My recordings.
This is an example of the sound recorder, which had a delay before it launched.
Sound recorder is muffled. The sound isn't brilliant. That's why I wanted to test it, because I know that sometimes the sound recorder app that you find on the Android operating system is good, and sometimes not so much. That one, not so much. I mean, look, it does what it needs to do, but the sound is muffled. I would recommend rather use if you want to record sound, such as in a conference or a class or what have you, use the camcorder function. You could put the camcorder, the video resolution, to as low as possible, so it doesn't eat up a bunch of space, and you could record sound with that, and the sound quality will be much better. Stopwatch. You do have a stopwatch integrated with the app, which is nice. Integrated with the phone, sorry. Start, pause, resume, reset. Stopwatch. Good to have. Okay. Google Talk, I don't use it. Task Manager, I showed you it. I love it. In fact, I'll do it right now. Thank you for the suggestion. Text Plus, it works great. TouchPal keyboard, I showed it. Twitter, I'm not going to go into it, it's Twitter. Videos is access to the videos on the phone, voice search, and YouTube. I basically showed everything that the phone can do. Now, thing is, as mentioned prior, I find that this actual on-screen, on-video demonstration was rather disappointing. I attribute it to the environmental factors right now. Maybe in cleaning my screen right before this video, I somehow damaged things, but I doubt it. Most likely what I would assume is it's because of the sheer heat and humidity and sweat emitting from my hands that is causing the screen to not respond very well. But for the most part, what I did experience in more ideal situations is the screen is very responsive, the device is very responsive. It doesn't handle Adobe Flash as well as a device with higher specs, such as a HTC Inspire 4G, which handled Adobe Flash better. However, it does handle it. For the most part, it handled all required apps with no problems. The phone itself is very light, the loudspeaker is very good, the microphone is very good on it, the Wi-Fi reception can't be beat. I have that beautiful task manager that I love, I have that email app that works wonders better than any other Android email app I've ever used. It's, frankly, I think, considering that it is a budget 4.3-inch smartphone, it's impressive. I'm completely satisfied with it. In fact, I'm making it my primary smartphone over my HTC Inspire 4G, which is much higher spec. But it's just the layout and the operation of the operating system and the device and the extra features such as the task manager, the email app, and what have you that I just love. I can't help but make this my primary choice. Things that I wish were better, I wish the video capture was far better. I wish the flash wasn't completely useless. I find flash useless. I would prefer if you were able to take images and video without having to have a micro SD card. Same thing for downloading files from websites or pre-caching maps using Google Maps Navigate with you know, crystal clear maps and road paths over a kilometer. All these things, I mean, there's 2.5 gigs or close to 2.5 gigs of usable storage space on the phone, internal. Why you need a micro SD card present, not entirely sure. Not too convinced by all that. But other than that, I'm just very much impressed with the phone. Oh, the TouchPal keyboard. The TouchPal keyboard is perhaps the new winner, the new champion of Android keyboard technology and just being very useful, very accurate. I love that the speech-to-text recognition actually holds the text in preview and allows you to accept it or reject it and just start anew. I love that. Love that it just doesn't regurgitate your message onto the screen, and if it's wrong, oh, well, now you fix it. I love the ability to get that cursor where you can move, the arrow keys, I should say, on screen so you can move your mouse cursor, your mouse, I'm a PC user, sorry, move your data entry cursor about to make adjustments. Overall, very, very much satisfied with the phone. Love its 4.3-inch screen of 800 by 480 resolution. Love the resolution, love the image. Oh, battery. Almost forgot, I apologize. Battery power. There was a lot of talk online about the battery, not just capacity, but the duration of the battery online. And many have said that the battery does not last very long. And I can tell you, as you can see, we've been on Wi-Fi, we've been fooling around, we've been opening a lot of apps. My battery is still nice and full. The battery, and once again, I bought this device used, so the battery's been used. The battery, from what I've experienced on Wi-Fi, has, I want to say a lot of stamina, has a lot of lasting power. However, I do have to say, when using the GPS and the network location and security, use wireless networks, which I left on, I shouldn't have, use wireless networks and use GPS satellites, if those things are both on, then the battery drinks. Oh boy. When I was out with the phone using GPS for, how long, realistically? Maybe an hour and 45 minutes. And the battery was maybe 3/4 depleted. I had GPS on all the time, you know, showing me on my Google Maps where I was going, what have you. But yeah, that alone drank perhaps 3/4 of the battery. So that was pretty heavy on battery. I can't comment on battery use when either making phone calls or using the cellular networks. I don't currently have an active public mobile account, so can't really test it as far as battery life goes. But I can tell you that the call quality is, for the most part, very good. From what I've experienced, it's, once again, it's not vast testing, but still, I am happy with it. Of course, the weight of the device, I appreciate very much. Of course, it seems to use a lot of thin, cheap plastics, as mentioned, but hey, I'm fine with that. The weight's down. I love that. And this is probably the third time I'm saying it, but the Wi-Fi reception is equally impressive. Well, there you go. I'll leave you with that. That is my review of the ZTE N860. I hope this information helps, and as usual, all the best.